So, why are you here? Do you know that?
To see you.
That's the best reason of them all. So, the time we are going into right now, you know, we have these waves of energy which is coming, doing the Maya calendar, doing the seasons, and we all feel them one way or another. And in this time, it is for what I call the wave one. It is about releasing old patterns. It's about all the things we have been suppressing through the years is somehow coming up to the surface. It is not the first time we have this wave and we're like, oh, are we done yet? Isn't it over? And the truth is somehow it's never over, right? We live and then we have to, we get born and then we have to live before we die. And in between that, we have all our emotions, experience, patterns, disattachment, become attached again, disattachment, become attached again. So it's an ongoing process in one form. But in another form, we do set ourselves more and more free. In another form, we do learn of our experiences. We do learn what serves us, what is truly for our hearts to feel, and what were from a mind perspective or something we learned in the past. So by these old patterns coming up over and over again, it is not to rub us in the face or saying, you're not there yet. It's to show us you came this far already. It's to show us first time you met this energy, you freaked completely out. 15th time you met this energy, you're actually handling it pretty well. So the reason it keeps coming up is to help us. To help us become free of what we once were trapped in. Does that make sense? So, anybody feel this wave in this time? I was asking if anybody is feeling this wave of old patterns coming up. Awesome.
I do.
And what do we do with them?
Just lift them.
Yeah. Yeah. So when we are doing the autopilot thing, like doing the same patterns day after day, waking up the same hour, going to work, having the same conversation, and maybe even making fight out of the same things in our relationships, then we are doing an automatic thing. Then we have learned ourselves. It's like riding a bike. But when you ride a bike a long time, it starts becoming a bit boring. And we start doing it automatically. We don't appreciate the ride any longer. It just is. So, to break free of the autopilot, we have to follow our heart. We have to feel what is actually what I want to do. Do I want to stand up 6 o'clock, go to this job? Do I want to react to this person in this particular way when he say hi to me every day? Or do I want to challenge myself and actually look him in the eyes and say, hi, how are you doing? To actually meet these people, to feel that we are alive, to allow other people to feel that they are alive as well. So in this time, because it's cold, and some people get winter depressed and stuff. We have the tendency to walk like this, not looking at each other. Somebody even go and like look grumpy. What if you could be that one person to change it? What if you could be that one person to look them in the eyes and say, hi. And that person will look up and you have touched something within that person that will make that person stay. So one thing is to help ourselves wake up. But another thing is from that perspective, we can help others as well. So this is one of the things I really feel in this time. It is that it's important that we listen to our hearts, that we see the perspective of the beauty within this time. Yeah, it's cold, but it's cozy. Yeah, there's a lot going on in the news, but what is actually touching us? What is actually in our daily life? Which reality do we wish to link to? What do we want to attract within our life? I totally love you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So another thing which is really going on in this time is the fear, the collective fear. And the collective fear is, for me, it's just really annoying, right? So I don't see the news, but I feel all this energy walking around, or flowing away in waves. So then you walk out nice and easily during the day, and this wave of fear just kind of hit you in the back. I'm like, oh, what's going on? Is the world going under? Oh, wait a minute. Is there war? No, there's not. Why do I even have defaults? Oh, now it's gone. That is from my perspective. So what is going on is that we have these news who hypes things just a slight bit, right? And when there's something we do not understand, we do not see the perspective from a higher perspective, but in the memories of what have been and what is in this moment, fear is triggered within us. When fear is triggered within us, we attract more things to be fearful for. So what we do is we relate on this lower frequency of fear, but collective fear is the fear you can't do something about. We cannot save the world by being afraid of it, right? We cannot save the world for having a war by fearing one guy from the other guy and actually want to fight the third one, but not do anything about it. So the only thing we do is maintain a vibration of fear, maybe hate, maybe anger, but without any possible outcome from that. So from an energetic, tell me if it goes too fast, right? Yeah? Awesome. Good. So from an energetic perspective, what we do is we maintain a low frequency, which will attract more low frequencies. So the war we are creating, the chaos we are creating by thinking, oh, there's gonna be chaos, and then chaos will come. If we believe truly from our heart that we can bring light, then we connect to the light. If we truly in our heart believe that everything can be love, we can all be one. It doesn't matter which color you have, it doesn't matter what country you're from, or you don't know how to walk, or you don't know how to wear normally shoes, you know? If we just could love each other and meet on that higher frequency, we could help the world raise the frequency. And then we can prevent the war and stuff like that will happen.
So the connection you're making to your heart, it begins with a thought, just a single thought?
No, it starts in your heart. And for your mind to understand what your heart is telling you in the three-dimensional world, you create a thought. When your head is starting, it is your mind or outside influence. And then you need to take it from your mind perspective down to feel in your heart if this is truly rightful for me. So every truth within you starts in your heart. Every doubt you have, you take to your head and then you breathe to your heart and then you feel, is this right for me or is it not? Make sense? Awesome. I'm never going to get tired of that word. It's like awesome. It's just awesome. Anybody of you guys heard about mind control? Yes, we got one guy who knows it. Woo! Oh, two! Nice. What is mind control?
You said he talked about the news, about movies, about everything we hear, see on television.
Yes.
And repeating, so it's to put it
in our mind. What is your knowledge about mind control?
I think it's
Yeah. So we have this physical incarnated mind control.
Physical incarnated mind.
And that is what they do on the news and exactly all the things you said. Then we have these energetic waves of mind control that interfere our thoughts. It can be, they can interfere our thoughts because of we have been through depressions or hard stuff in our life, so we can resonate with our low frequencies. You know, when the mind start telling you, you're not good enough, maybe you should go kill yourself, hey, blah, 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 blah. You know that thing going on? That is also a part of the mind control. But the beautiful thing, about mind control is that nothing from the outside can control you unless you allow it. So by you knowing who you are, like knowing who your heart is, where your heart is, nothing can interfere. You can still hear that voice. I still have that voice in my head, telling me weird stuff sometimes. It can tell me to kill myself 3 times before I'm out of my bed sometimes. Like, okay, good morning, you know? But as long as I do not link to it emotionally, it is just a thought. It has absolutely no control over me whatsoever. If I have resistance on it, it will grow. If I allow it, but do not link to it, then it's just there until it's there no longer. Like an annoying voice, you know, the beep sometimes, right? Sort of kind of the same. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anybody beside me who have voices in their heads? Just making sure.
You said when you have a thought, you can also check with your heart if it's really what you want or not.
Yes.
That's the thing. How do you check with your heart? How do you feel what your heart wants?
When your mind stop questioning how to do it.
But if your mind doesn't stop questioning how to do it,
then you haven't done it yet. No. So the first thing that you have to learn is that, oh, wait a second. Okay. So the first thing you have to learn is that you are doubting everything because you doubt that you're not good enough. You think you always have to prove that you are something because of something in your childhood. But the thing is, you just have to be. So no matter which choice you make, it is always the right one. If you walk out of a way where you're like, oh, whoops, I shouldn't have dated that guy, you know? It's just a part of your track. And then you know better next time. So instead of being afraid of making a choice, then just do it. For you, it's all about allowing yourself to know that you are exactly good enough. Exactly how you are. You cannot make a wrong choice. No matter what choice you make, it's the choice you were meant to make. And when you allow that, it becomes easier for you to listen, because until then you will keep being in your mind, questioning yourself, is this right or is this wrong? Okay, I'm trying to feel it. And then your mind is like, I am doubting if I'm feeling it right now. So when we try to judge a feeling, it will never flow. But by surrendering completely into no matter what I feel, no matter what choice I make, it's completely okay. Then you surrender into actually allow yourself to feel. And no matter what you feel, it is always the right feeling. Because what you feel is your own feelings. And there's no judgment over that. Any other questions?
What if your heart scares you?
Is it then your heart that scares you, or are you afraid of your heart?
I think I'm afraid of my heart.
Yes. Why?
Sometimes it's like I want this very much, but then I give up something else that's also very dear to me, and then, oh my God, what am I going to...
But that is so awesome. That is the awesome thing with this thing. So we have the fear, right? The fear of the unknown. And on the other side of fear, it's just love. But there's also, when you follow your heart, you're following your true self. If you stay stuck within something because your mind says so, or because you love the people who are there, of course, but it's not meant for you to stay, then your heart is taking you away. Should you then maintain where you are, not listening to your heart, and fear the truth that lies within you? Or should you follow your heart and still love the people and the choices you are in, but love yourself more and know that by walking away, you're actually helping everybody by following their own truth? I love everybody. It's like crazy. I do. I fall in love every day in different ways, of course. Like, oh, that's probably so nice. I love it. But it doesn't mean that I have to live together with everybody. It doesn't mean that I have to stay the same place my whole life or only give lecture in one city because I really love that city. It means that I am here until my heart no longer feels I'm supposed to be here. And then I walk the direction my heart guides me, because that is what I meant to do. That is what I feel is right for me. By walking away, I allow people to follow their heart and their truth as well. If I maintain in a situation where my heart is not truly there, how can I be there truly for the people I'm with? Then I'm there from a perspective of love for them, but not loving me and them enough to be there with all that I am. Then there's only a frequency of me. And I know, for a person who feels everything within anybody, I don't want anybody standing next to me unless they really truly want it from the inside. If their heart wants them to go somewhere else, I will love with all of my heart, all of my soul, that they walk that direction. Because nothing is real if you are not fully in it. And the fear of the unknown, right? But that's awesome. That's like skydiving. So we fear so much that our legs are shivering. Everything is like nervous in our body. And we're like, oh, seriously? I can't do that. I can't do that. I don't know what is on the other side. It's way too dangerous. What about my finances? What about my children? What if I lose my house? It's like something like that, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, what if? What is the very worst thing that can happen? No house, money from the bank, and the kids choose to be part-time with you and part-time with the father. But you followed your heart. You changed your perspective. You no longer feel stuck because you did something unknown. You did something new. And that allows you to feel a new perspective of yourself. That allows you to feel a deeper layer within what you truly are, what you truly want. And by you taking the courage to be who you truly are, you are being the very, very best example for your kids. In this time, the kids are so sensitive. They're so open, they're so sensitive. If we think for 1 second we can be as we were 20 years ago, sitting and just playing, okay, we are not going to tell the kids that we are going to get divorced. We're not going to tell about our financial issues. We're just going to maintain this fake smile. It ain't going to work. Nope. They will feel it straight away and then we'll go a little bit crazy. So we have to be in touch with our feelings, to be in touch with them where they are, because they are all about the feelings. They are truly a gift for this time, for us to develop from where we were to where we wish to be. In order of understanding them, we have to understand ourselves. We have to start listening to ourselves, have to start letting go of the old patterns of control we have from our parents and our sisters, and learn to follow our hearts. Because then we can resonate with them. Then we can understand them, and then they can understand us.
I have a question.
Yes.
Okay, I'll help with this. I'm in a job, and I know I can say my heart tells me I'm not in the right place.
Mm-hmm.
But still, I work there, and I'm very afraid to let go, and because I don't have anything else. So. I don't really know what to do, how to. I want to do something. I want to break this pattern. But yeah, there are no other options.
Can I borrow you for 2 seconds?
Yeah.
Okay. So, what you want to do is stand up for yourself.
Yes.
And believe that whatever job you want to have, you can get. So if you are a place where you don't want to be, you stand up for yourself and you feel, okay, what do I have to learn here? I have to learn to stand up for myself.
Yes.
And when I learned that, I'm ready to walk away from this place.
Yeah, that's a big
got
lesson.
It.
So scary.
That was so awesome, actually. You can do
so
it.
Nice.
I was like, oh, you're just been showering.
I have. Yeah. I'm just so scared of, you know,
standing up for yourself. But do you know how great it feels? Imagine standing up here, right? Blah, 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 blah. Try to say blah, 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 blah.
Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah? See? It's actually pretty awesome.
Yeah.
It works. So just go to work and do exactly the same thing. Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, I'm leaving. Bye.
Yeah. Doi, doi.
Doi, doi.
See? It feels great already.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It just takes a little courage.
Yeah, but you will get there.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
So, anybody else don't want to quit some jobs? Yes?
What can you do about self-hate?
So the first thing we have to learn, I'm gonna keep sitting down today, I don't know what this is all about. So the first thing is that you have to understand where you come from. You have to understand how you were brought up, which consciousness level you had in that time. So you were not aware of what you did until that you became conscious about it. That part you have to forgive yourself about. You have to forgive yourself for what you were not conscious about and understand that all you ever tried to do was being as good as possible from the perspective which you had at that time, which has shifted over the years, of course. Yeah. So all self-hate comes from our lack of understanding of that you are just love. We are first capable of changing something when we become aware of it. Now you are aware. And now you take it into changes. So instead of hating yourself, you have to look at it with love. Look at it as you are no longer stuck. You no longer did what you did. You now do everything in a new way. You can see things from a completely other perspective. You should be proud of yourself. So what we can do with self-hate is look at where it comes from. Understand there's nothing to hate. And forgive yourself. And when you reach the point where you have forgiven yourself, you will realize there was nothing to forgive.
Yeah. I see.
And every time you see something with love, when you look me in the eyes and think, oh, she's crazy but I love her, realize that what I sent back is this very same love for you. I don't think you're so crazy, but I do love you. And allow that to go inside of you. Allow yourself to take it in. Yeah. And then, step by step, replacing that self-hate with self-love and self-respect. And see your true worth.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You're cold.
I'm sorry. No, that is a special skill I have. Oh no, I'm used to it. I don't feel it anyway. No. Oh.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hi.
Hi. I had a question regarding the generation difference between my mom and me.
Yes.
And that I have been brought up in a certain way, which is quite...
in a box.
Yeah, square, rigid, and I'm feeling that I'm breaking out of it, and I'm being open for other type of information, and feeling good with it.
Yes.
And now I feel that it comes, now it's my turn to look to her and maybe make her some concept clear or bring her with me, or in a way that I find really hard to do so. And I just feel that sometimes she can give in, but a lot of times she's quite rigid still.
The thing is, if we truly want to help people, the only thing we can do is first help ourselves and be the example. So when she asks something, you can give it to her from a clear perspective, seeing this is how it works for me, this is how I am, this is what I feel, this is what I do, this is what it do for me. But when we have an intention of helping somebody, especially if it's our parents, it's like, look, I got the truth, this is the truth, come on, why are you standing there when this is the truth? And they are not ready to see it from that perspective. They have all these different layers. You also have the layers of, you are my son. I am helping you. I'm not gonna take this in. Even I'm taking something in because we have this, you have a deep connection with her, but she still has this responsibility feeling. She has the layers and the patterns for where she's from, right? We have to respect that. We have to understand that those closest to us often is those who are the most hard to help, right? Because we have all the greatest attention in the world, but then what we try to do comes from a not pure perspective. It comes from a ego, not in a bad ego I will possess you way, but an ego perspective of, please let me show you the truth because I want to set you free. I want that you are free. But what if she is not ready? So what you can do, it's increasing your own happiness. It's just showing and shining out what this openness is doing for you. It's looking into the patterns which you still have within your brain and go even more to your heart. How can I truly become free inside of myself? How can I truly be happy by making me happy? What makes me smile? What makes me experience this world in an open perspective so I feel that I'm no longer in this box? Because you still have the feeling of being in a box. So when you can feel that from the inside, when you shine that out, when your eyes start shining, when you allow yourself to, then she can see it. And then it's on her side to ask. It's on her side to dare to step through. And then you can give her every answer, every direction by showing him, like on a map. But she has to take the steps and not you carrying her. It is the very same for me. I can stand here and say blah, 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 right? 4 hours over and over again. But what you do with it, it is yours. It's completely yours. I'm not taking anybody in their arm and say, come on, this is my light, and you're going to stand next to it in my light, so you never will feel your own. No. Because then I'm not helping anybody. You see what I mean? Awesome. I like when you smile. See? Just go home and smile. Any other questions?
Well, I think it's the same from a mother to her children.
Yes. It is the very same.
And that and that, and they don't want to hear it.
No. It is also because we always want the best for those we love, right? And when we have the perspective which we somehow have created, everybody have different perspective, and we create this perspective, and when we want something for somebody, we always want the truth, the best for them. But it's not sure that what we feel is best for them actually is best for them. It's not sure that they're ready to take the steps, which for us is obvious to see that, yeah. A, go to the left, you know, then you don't have to sit around there for ages. But they have to take it in their tempo. It is like everybody I know sort of kind of, it's like children, right? Not that I'm a great mom or something, but like, it is not sure they're ready to see the world as I see it. I don't think anybody's ready to see the world exactly how I see it. But I know that by showing how I see it and saying how I feel it, they can take what they are ready for within their perspective. They can take what they want to develop in their truth that will bring them their direction. They are not meant to go my direction. Your children is not meant to go yours. But they are meant to go the direction which they feel is the most right for them in this present moment. Yeah. Sometimes we have to walk in circles. Sometimes we have to do things that really, really hurt us in order for us to become more free on the other side. I sure run my head through the wall like a billion of times. I even got married in Syria without, I know it was the most stupid thing ever, but I was like, die now, die later. I just wanted to do it. And without that, I would never have been here. Without that, I will never grow as much as I have been growing. If I never touched rock bottom, if I never have felt so miserable I just wanted to die, I will never learn to appreciate how beautiful life would be. How awesome it is to feel that I want to live. Oh my God, there's a bird, there's a bird, there's a bird flying. Oh, that's amazing, you know? How many people have that feeling? Only if they have truly been on the other side. So do not fear for your kids to make wrong choices. That very wrong choice might be the very reason that they one day will shine twice as much as you could ever imagine. This is like the silent crowd. So, were you saying something, Tom?
Many people have a relation with just two people in one house.
Yes.
But the way you are living is, as I know you, when you listen to your heart and then you feel free,
yes,
you can like someone else and someone else and someone else and have fun with them.
Yes.
But that's not so easy in this society. Everybody, when everybody does it, and they all can do it, but then I think it's a bit difficult in this society.
To follow your heart and have fun with those you want to have fun with?
No, but then you don't live with two people in one house, but then everyone is going his own way.
Yes and no.
I'm just interested.
Yes. So, wait a second, I have to have blood in my head. Huh, got it. So, me and my body is learning, yeah? So, the thing is, what your heart is telling you might be, I want to live with this person for the rest of my life. And it doesn't mean that I don't want to say hi to you and hug you and do-do-do-do-do, but I want to be with this person because I'm truly connected within the heart, and therefore we will do everything together and live together to the day we die. Mm-hmm. Because both of your hearts is guiding you that direction. then there will be other people. There will be like, oh, I feel that person and I want to be with that person and I truly want to be with that person in all weird perspective, right? Because that is the experience you have chosen within this life. So if you ask me if everybody follows their heart, if it just don't want to be cares, yes and no. It will be what it's meant to be. And sometimes people have this whole realization of who they are, the letting go of ego perspective, going in to follow their true heart, and they have to run around and do weird stuff to realize that inside of themselves, maybe they actually just want to be in this house, or they want to move around and shift perspective every second month. But they never find out if they never listen to themselves. Then they will suppress something, then will walk around in this house, living together, not even look at each other, just, hi, how was your day? Oh, it was nice, honey. So, I love you. Yeah, I love you too. That's so dead. That's so dead. Mm-hmm. And it's only making hurtful. It makes people ill. It makes you feel not seen, less worthy. It makes you feel fat or whatever human perspective you can put to that emotion, right? So then you seek it elsewhere. Then you seek it elsewhere. Yeah, is that how?
Then you seek it elsewhere.
That sounds better like that. Then you seek it elsewhere. No, I never get it. Lost it.
Okay, I understand. But you can also have different layers of heart connections. So you feel a lot of heart connections with one, other one, and what is the other person with the other person.
Yes.
So it's not. It doesn't have to mean that you live together with not seeing each other and not loving each other, but you can have more heart connections. And that's...
Can confuse people.
It can be a little complicated, I think.
So what if you realize that you love everybody?
Yeah, I do realize.
That everybody has a heart connection, that every time I look somebody in the eyes, I feel a heart connection.
Okay, yes, I agree with you, but that's still... Doesn't mean that you...
What is the exact question?
with who you will live together. Because we have a tendency to live with...
The one you're connected with.
Yeah, or you don't live with everybody. So, that's what you said.
There probably is this one person you feel more than only the heart connection with, right? That you also physically are attracted to. That somehow being with that person, it makes you feel that you can be truly you. That you want to create, that it feels like you can expand and create together. In a form that feels more free and more explosive and more energetic than all the other heart connection. That it's where you actually meet on the same level in the heart where it's... It goes like this.
Yeah.
Okay. And other heart connections is... So, why I keep answering the same question from different perspectives, it is because the question which you ask, it's an answer which you seek, but you seek it from your mind perspective. So no matter what I will tell you now, it will not make sense. But... those who are meant to find somebody, soulmate, twin soul flame, whatever we're gonna call it, human love, they will find it. And how to feel the difference? Seek it.
Seek it.
Seek it. Go out, feel it. Look people in the eyes, feel how it feels in your whole system. Am I attracted to this person? Where does the energy come from? Do I feel like my energy is expanding? Is this from a pure perspective? Is this truly my heart telling me, I can just be, you can just be, let's just be? Or is it me stepping into your world reality because I'm curious about what this is about, but I'm losing a part of me? So then I'm not true to myself, but I'm following my heart. Until I'm no longer following my heart and then I become aware I have to step out of it again. Only one can guide you, and that is your heart. But if you try to figure it out already before stepping in, forget about it. Then we will keep wondering, what if? I hate that one, right? What if?
That's the thing. It's like if you've not listened to your heart so long, like if you've been what you exactly just explained? You've been going because it felt good.
Yes.
But you've not followed your gut instinct. And then for such a long time, and now you're like, you really hit the wall and you're out of it. And now it's like you have all these choices to make.
Yes.
It's like, which one am I going to make? Because what if I'm going to do the same thing and do the same mistake again?
So everything you have been done, everything you did until now, if we, instead of looking at it like my words is just not functioning, you know that feeling?
Yes.
Awesome. So if we look at it from another perspective, as it, if it is not mistakes, but it was meant to, that it was there for a reason. Every person I walked into, every time I have opened my heart, like I do that every day, but, and every relationship you walk into, every brother you meet, every lover you meet, every sister you meet, have something to show you inside of yourself. If it's not showing you what you want, it's showing you what you don't want. So instead of it, of looking at it as being mistakes until now, look into what you learned.
Well, I can look at it as what I learned, though now I feel the difference when your heart is open and when you
close,
find yourself and listen to what you want and, you know, stand up for yourself. And but then, like, you've kind of closed chapters behind you, mm-hmm. and now it's like all these new chapters are opening.
Yes.
But which door, which path are you going to take?
The one you want the most.
Yeah. The one you feel you want the most.
Exactly.
And then we get the same question which I had before.
Well, then go talk with all of them.
Right. That's what I did.
Good.
Yeah.
Or else you don't know.
Yeah.
So if you feel like all these hard connections to all these people, yeah. then go meet them. There's a reason why you feel all of them at once. Mm. And it doesn't mean that you have to like have a physical relationship to all of them at all. You can just go meet people. It is just your soul meeting a different part of source soul in another physical form, right?
Yeah.
So look into what that person have to give to you and what you have to bring them. There's no just mentality. As long as you just meet them for who they are without any intention other than, hey, what is this about?
Yeah.
Just allow yourself. And maybe it's none of them. Maybe they're going to come somebody afterwards. Most likely something like that. Or else you wouldn't doubt.
Right. Yeah. A lot of doubting.
Doubt is awesome.
Yeah.
So I feel everything and nothing at the same time. Town, same time.
Mm-hmm.
That can be a lot of doubting. And sometimes I doubt so much that I even get myself panic attacks. It's really stupid, right?
Mm-hmm.
So instead of standing 1 hour to look at which parachute that will be the most functional to wear in this second, I just walk bare feet. It's like, oh, never mind. But doubt is good. Doubt can be annoying when you keep being in doubt, when you keep being like, so, la, 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 and it come nowhere.
Yeah, doing nothing.
Yeah. But by making a choice, crossing the doubt into whether it is the right or the wrong choice, by making a choice you are doing, you are starting the energy, you are allowing yourself to take a step through the doubt. And then you learn to trust yourself. We fear so much making the wrong choices, but there is no wrong, there is no right. So what is fear really about? There's only experiences. Some of them hurts, some of them is really fun, but it's all a part of life. If we only had good experience, we will not know the difference. And I have seen how it is. I can even remember how it is when everything is just love and light. There's nothing else. There's no physical form. There's no physical body. There's no five senses, which is really awesome down here. There's no hate. There's no doubt. There's no anger. There's no fear. There's no nervosity.
Nervousness.
Awesome. And frankly, it's quite boring. Because you don't know there is anything else. It's just, how are you? Yay! That's it. You know? Are you sure? Yes! Okay. Yay! So to be here, to have a human experience, to feel, to live, we need to have it all. We need to have all the aspects. Yes?
I've got a question. My English is very bad.
So no, it's not that
so
bad.
I hope that you understand me.
But,
I feel what you say. I feel I live like that, I guess, the last year. And I feel it in my heart. And that my body is, what is hecht, gehecht?
Attached.
Yeah, to pain. It looks like it's... I was always sick in my childhood, and it I don't know. Sometimes I guess it's an excuse. I can let it go, but I'm not sure if it's that. Do you understand?
So if your body remember pain,
yeah,
and that is all your body remember, and you take pain away, what's left of you? So what do you fear? Losing yourself.
So that will always be
no. Yes, you have to live in fear and in pain to the day you die. You're doomed.
No, okay, I deal with that.
No,
I'm happy, so that's no problem.
It's about coming consciousness about it. It's about coming consciousness about why I hold on to the pain. It's a kind of security. My body was used to pain. Well, tons of pain. I don't even feel pain like pain. Mm-hmm. I just feel it like, oh, I have a body. Oh yeah, whoops. Wait a minute, I broke my foot.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah, that, okay.
But then you come conscious about it, and then you can start taking other feelings in like, oh, I feel my body because it's tinkling inside of it. Oh my God, that's so awesome.
Yeah, I know that too. That's also nice. You know?
That's a little bit more nice, right?
Yeah.
But that is one thing. Another thing is, so this whole happy feeling is something new for you. This whole integration of allowing you to be who you are without the pain perspective is unknown ground. Mm-hmm. That means you feel insecure. So the pain is actually your security. It's your safe zone. So when you go back to that, it's known. You know what it is. It's pain. I've been here for ages. I can deal with it. This
yeah, it's not
feeling.
Only pain, it's also to really tired and stuff like that.
Really tired is because you are... So when you shift perspective from... like, let's take a person who has been depressed, right? Mm-hmm. And that person wants to become free. So the first time, I'm going to change it. So I was locked in. I locked myself in for... sometime, and then I had to walk outside. I stopped being afraid. The first time I had to walk to my gym and walk home, I was exhausted. I was like, oh my God, it took so much energy. There was 1 million people and they barely eat me. It's like I can feel all the pain because I resonate with that frequency of lower frequency. So I was just absorbing it all, and I was lying home like, oh my God, I'm never gonna go out again, right? So it took so much energy. That was first time. Second time I went out to do something fun. It was really fun. I was so happy. But when I came home, I became so heavy. And I had all these crazy feeling, all these crazy thought of what I wasn't and what I will never be and blah, 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 blah. Because when you have been somewhere where there's dark inside of you and you go somewhere, when you come brighter, then you feel everything which is still in there. And it sort of kind of brings you a bit down. So it is in a transformation process. Mm-hmm. And it's becoming aware of that. It's allowing yourself to step from the known into the unknown. It's allowing yourself to take the time which you need to become more free and more happy within yourself. And no, you have not listening to your heart for the last year. You're getting to go there. You're starting, but you still doubt yourself a lot. And you're not allowing yourself to fully be who you are. But you are getting there a lot. Okay. And when you look at the patterns, oh, do you want to know it? Oh, okay, good. Check question. When you look in the patterns for which you are following, it's from your childhood and it's still linked to the interfering between your mom and your dad, mostly the part from your mom. And that is still holding you down. So in some of your movements and the way you interact with people, this perspective from your mom's energy is coming up and you act from that. Mm-hmm. So when you come conscious about it, you can let go of that part so you can start becoming who you are by actually try to find them. But what is me? What is what I've learned from others? Mm-hmm. And step by step, letting go of that. Because you are awesome. And you have a shining heart and you want the best for people. I know for sure. But you have to learn to feel that. You have to learn to let go of whatever have held you down and allow yourself to truly just, you know.
Okay.
Check.
Okay, I lay back. It will go.
Yes. Go home and sleep about it.
Yeah.
It will come for sure. It's.
Earnest. I know.
We have these. We have these bright moments, right, of, ah, this is awesome, this is what I want, I can feel it, this is freedom. And then we come home and somebody hit us with a hammer in the head. I'm like, oh my God, I'm set back for 15 years or something. And then what do we feel? What do we link to? Not the happy feelings, like, oh my God, I'm back, right? So what we could do was shift perspective. See the good, see, but hey, I did awesome. Maybe I feel like shit right now, but I did awesome 5 minutes ago. So by putting our attention to the awesomeness instead of the hammer in the head, we increase that by increasing the happiness inside of you. And then the hammer becomes less, because then we stop punching ourselves that hard. Not by denying that it's there, accepting it, but simply increasing the happiness and the light inside of you and seeing the awesomeness. Yeah.
Yeah, so what you were saying about absorbing all the
energy of the people you walk
yes.
through.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's also kind of hard for me.
Yes.
So how do you deal with it? Because I always thought that it had nothing to do with me, but when I hear you, you say it's like it's attracted to you.
The frequency which you remain in that moment.
Yes.
So there's different between people. There's different between how sensitive you are and how open you feel is. And if you look into how sensitive you are, you're really sensitive. Yes, we knew. But you're also really happy. Of course you have like lower self-esteem once in a while and have to learn to stand up for yourself. But it's not because of you having anger or heavy feelings inside of you. You're resonating with these people. It's because you have to learn to stand up and be who you are. For you, it's because you have to learn to shine out your light. Allow yourself to fill in this world. Allow yourself to be. And as you take place within you, you are shining out your light, you're shining out your frequency. And then because your frequency actually is pretty high, then lower frequency do not interfere. If I'm tired, I'm like, you know, then I become more tired. Mm-hmm. But when I'm just standing and I'm who I am, then I'm shining out whatever I am. And that means I can maintain what I am without taking all of you guys' feelings in. I can feel you though, but I'm not taking it in like it's mine.
Yes. So another person's anger can relate to my fear.
Yeah.
Or my insecurity, or my pain, or
sadness. So if a person is angry, he send out a very anger is awesome, you know. Anger is powerful and is a source of creation. So if I'm standing here being very angry. This is me pretending to be angry. Yes. Good gedank, Mensch. And this is me pretending to be Dutch. So, if I'm standing here being very angry, the frequency of angry is intensive, and then, you know, it's like zigzag form like that. So when it's coming, it's like... So if we over here just being love and light and very sensitive and not really standing strong within that sensitivity, it feels like, oh my God, he's going to eat me. And then you can feel the anger because somehow that energy feels stronger than your energy.
Yes.
It is not the trick case, but that is how it feels. So by you realizing, hey, this crazy woman, she told me that love and light actually have the highest frequency. So if I just love him, just imagine like flowers falling down upon him. Trust me, angry people become so funny. And it works. Because then you don't have to take it in. He's angry. It's not yours. You can be who you are. Just make him. I make people into cartoon figures all the time. I don't even know how to not to do it. Sorry. And I don't. But it works. So, like in the gym, I love being in the gym, like working out and stuff. And sometimes I also am really, really open. Sometimes I'm open. Sometimes I'm more aware of it than others. And I come in and I feel like, oh, I don't know, and I don't know where to hide, and maybe I do things wrong, and you know, the whole mind thingy. And all these big guys are standing there, you know? And then seriously, something inside of me happened, I'm like, this is so funny. Because then I imagine them being all kind of animals jumping around. And all of a sudden, my workout is just fine. You know, I'm not thinking they're angry, and if they're looking at me like, you know, I'm just like, what's up, gorilla? Trust me, it works. It's not always I tell them, though, but inside of my head, it's pretty good. You're welcome. It is, yes?
Illnesses always have a message for you.
Oh, yeah. And illnessness... Please, somebody give me real words. The truth is that all diseases is creative, created for a reason. It is not diseases, it is your body trying to communicate with you. Unless you chose to have these diseases before you came to the planet, then it's for the perspective of your own and for the people around you.
How to know the difference?
The difference doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter, no, I see.
Those who, for example, we have these kids who die of cancer very young, right? They're sent here and they were meant to die. I died when I was 6 years old because there was like this flood taking me in another life. I died when I was 24, right? Yeah, 24. Because I had to die. I only had to come and be the light for amount of time. And by taking that light away, the friction within the people surrounding me was so high that was what's meant to happen. And it's the same for these cancer kids. They are being an example. They are waking us up. It's like, hey, something is seriously wrong in our society if our kids have cancer when they are born, right? It's like, this is not normal. We're doing something not right. So what I want to say, because I can't remember the question, is that those kids who are incarnated and meant to die early, or their soul is aware. So it's not that they are in a in between state. It's not that they are going to suffer in the next life or something. They are aware.
But they suffer now.
Huh?
They suffer in this life.
No. Yes, no. Yes and no. Yes, because what is suffering? No, because in a way, if you look into those souls, if you look into what they do, how they handle it,
yeah,
it is actually pretty beautiful. If you see how open they are, if you see how many intimate, how do you pronounce it?
Yeah.
Oh, intimate moments. If you see how many intimate moments you have with these people, it has so much value. Emotionally, frequencies, vibrational message, it has so much beauty within it. You can have a whole life with a family and not see each other. Then you can have 10 years with somebody who's gonna die and love that person to pieces those 10 years, more than you would if you had each other for a life. It's a little bit sad, but it's true. So let's not judge a situation, but always seek for the most beautiful outcome. Let's not be together in supporting the illness or let everything be about the illness. No, but let it be about increasing the happy moments. Let it be about increasing the health and the happiness and the joy inside of you as inside of them. That is how we set ourselves free. I don't believe in diseases.
In?
In diseases. I believe in perspective and in what we can create ourselves. And I do believe that chronicles do not exist.
So health you could create too.
Health?
You could health be
yes.
Healthy.
Oh yeah. It is all about so it from I get all these perspectives, right? So then I'm like, okay, which one should I describe it from? So if you look into increasing a person's health, there is these people who are born with the genes of their parents. So the DNA is a frequency within your cells, which allow your body to respond in a certain way because all your ancestors respond in that way. So when you are to increase your health, it's not only your own health within this life, you also have to increase the health within yourself from your ancestors' life. So your belief system have to be strong enough for you to allow yourself to set yourself free from these genes control patterns. Yeah? So if you're capable of doing that, you can change your DNA into become completely free.
Sounds easy.
Yeah. Just like that.
Can you say it again a bit slowly? I don't understand what you said.
Oh my god.
You can
what did I say? You can change your DNA by your. I never remember what I say.
Yeah.
Mindset. So if you are in the belief, let me take another example. Yeah. Everything in frequencies, right? So this wall is moving, but the frequency within this wall is moving so slowly that it becomes physical, three-dimensional, not nice to put your hand into. So if I, within my mind and all the cells within my body, all the DNA within my whole system, my whole being and all the other beings who are in my being, I in all dimensions at the same time, yeah, is in the belief that my hand can vibrate as slowly as this wall, or we can vibrate as fast as a light together, my hand can go through this wall. But every cell within this body, within my mind, within my soul and everything, all dimensions, have to be in that belief. Or else maybe my fingertip will go in and I'm stuck. This is the same with the DNA changing. You have to believe it with all your cells in your body.
And this is the level what I mean with my body.
Yeah. I know. But your body has to learn and relearn. So you have to learn what it means to be in your body by feeling other things than pain. And that life that you allow to be loved and feel love inside of yourself within this life. And it takes some times. And the whole combo thing, just keep doing it. I have this nerve thing. It works.
I had a question when you talked about reincarnation.
Yeah?
I feel that there's a lot of pain that I carry from other lives and that I don't know how to deal with sometimes, or sometimes also dimensions, and I don't really know them. It's a feeling I have, and I don't know.
So, if we look into, I love all you guys' feelings. We are all silent, but we feel a million things. So, if you look into how many lives you have been living on this planet, it's quite a lot already now. If you look into what your soul are to remember within this lifetime, it is because the deep of your soul has something to unsolve or resolve or relive within this life. So if you can't grab it yet, allow it to be. If you know it's there for whatever reason, it's because it wants to show you something when the time is right. And if you look deep inside to it, if you look down into the feelings that you cannot solve, if you look at movies, for example, and you feel something resonate, and you're not sure why, but if they kill witches, for example, like, oh, I feel this so much, that's probably because you were killed as a witch. And why do you feel that? Because you have to realize what you are in this life. So you have to have memories of what you were back then. Is she telling me something? Oh, slightly.
Sure.
So sometimes it's also because we have been in a matrix for a long time where people cannot see who we are. And that allows us not to see ourselves. And then it's like walking around this illusion where everything just is weird. And then one day somebody comes to look us in the eyes and we realize maybe we're not that lost. You just have to see yourself first. And trust me, there's more of you. Yeah. And they're pretty awesome. And you allow yourself to just be who you are. People who does the same will see you. And you have a beautiful heart and everything else which you feel, it is just what the outside have learned you, it's not what you are. Not even close. So every time you feel that happy feeling inside, when that is there, that is you. Everything else, it is not you. So I'm gonna hug you and you're gonna feel it. And that feeling, that is real. Okay.
I'm serious, I'm gonna hug you.
So part of your soul knows that you do not really belong on Earth, but we are here for a reason. And we can make it our home. So I usually say we can create paradise on home, but we have paradise on Earth. But we have to create it inside of ourselves first. Or else we can't feel it. Because no matter what we will see, will only be an illusion of what we have taught until now.
Yeah, makes sense.
You're welcome. Thanks. So, you guys just hungry or is there more questions? Yes.
You said something when you were standing there about other energies, other lives are in your being now.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about that? What do you mean by that?
I mean, from which perspective? Oh no. So, you have your physical body. your physical body is created out of self and out of vibrations. Those vibrations, it's made out of the soul imprint which you are meant to have within this life, so you're capable of doing what you're sent here to do, and also your parents, which you have chosen to be your physical parents. So some of their DNA, some of their vibrations, some of their body memories is stuck within your system. So you're actually acting out of their patterns in your physical being. Until you become aware of it, and then you can change it. That is one thing. Yeah, what was the question? Did I answer it?
Yes, in a way.
Yes and no. Yeah, that is the physical part. Then you have your whole soul, and your soul have the memories of all the life you have been living. It is like you have this catheter, like a library. I always see it like this. This is so awesome. Have you seen Bruce the Almighty when he opened the drawer and then he's like to the other side? So we have this whole system of files, right? And what your soul remember is feelings, it's emotions, it's the process that you have been through. It only remembers the things which touch your soul, because that is what you're here to experience, have this human experience within the emotion and perspective. So that you have with you when you come down here. It is your soul. It feels, you can feel it in the deep in your soul. When you look people in the eyes, you can see, whoa, he's been living here for like 1,000 years, you know, it's like just that deep. But the memories, it's partly taking away, so you can relive every time you're incarnated, so you can have this experience over and over again. Know how it is to grow up, know how it is to create a self, even that your soul have a self. So you gain more to your perspective. Have I still not answered your question?
Well, it's always, all things are happening now. There is no really past. Are there past lives or?
Yes, of course.
There is a past.
Yeah, past lives? Yeah, many. I remember many of mine.
And you recognize that in yourself?
Yes. In the beginning, I did not know. I did not know what it were. I could not name it. I could not place it. I could just feel it. I woke up in the middle of the night, have Chris traumas, like when I was 4 years old, and I never seen anything else than Disney movies. So there is these memories, the soul's memories, and it comes back in the order that you need them. It's not all of us who is meant to remember our past lives, because it do not serve us within this life to remember. More and more of us becomes aware that there is past life, because it serves the collective in this time that we have the awareness about that. Because that can help us in a collective way to expand. Yeah. And set ourselves free, let go of some of the fear of dying, for example. When we are aware that nothing ever ends, that everything always will be, then we don't feel living. And when we don't feel living, we might start doing it. And what is the worst thing that can happen? Game over, try again.
Why don't Katie says the worst that can happen is a fault.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally right.
Yeah.
What did you say?
I said Byron Katie.
Yeah. You know,
she says the worst that can happen is a thought.
Oh,
yeah. She said, what's the worst that can happen?
Yeah. That's a good one.
Can I ask you a personal question? How did this get to you? Like, how did you find out, I can plug into some other knowledge?
Oh, I always was the knowledge.
Yeah.
I don't know how to plug out.
No.
So, I have sort of kind of always been what I am. Like, yeah. We all are what we are,
yeah.
Right?
For you it was...
normal. But yeah. I was not aware it was not normal for everybody else. So, I was just walking around being all love and light and telling people about their great dead grandfather and what they truly feel and stuff like that, and seeing them as colors. But the moment I became aware of it was because my ex-boyfriend died, and my friend, he was also my very good friend, and I was at his grave with his mom.
Yeah.
And it was so funny because he was like sort of kind of sitting on his grave.
For you.
And he was like telling me all this stuff about how he was feeling now and what happened when he died. I could just feel it and like open the perspective and in his room and stuff. So I told his mom. And then we went home to where he lived. And then because I always, when I was in the bathroom, I usually open all the doors and stuff. So he was literally saying, "You are so crazy. Why do you always do that? And now I know you're doing that because now I can see it." And we had this whole conversation and I had so much fun. And then because I'm not aware until people look at me and makes me aware. So then his mom was like,
"What are you doing?"
Yeah, well, how do you know that? How do you know how Lasse died? What, you know, that whole feeling? And then she drove me home. And when she put me off, I just walked to the beach. And I think I just lay in the sand for hours and staring in the air like, what just happened? Because that was the first time I was aware that whatever I was doing, it was not normal. But the other time I talked with dead people, I didn't know they were dead. So for me, it was the first time I realized, hey.
Yeah.
So, okay. And then I started developing it from there. I went to talk with a woman who was like clairvoyant. And I were a clairvoyant, like a seer. Clairvoyant.
Oh, clairvoyant. Sorry. Yes, yeah. Of course. Yeah.
Pronounce the words right, Elisa. Yes, I will try. Try.
It's okay. We'll find it out.
And being at her courses, I all of a sudden realized everything that I was by realizing. So we had to like put our hands over somebody's back to feel where it goes up and where it goes down. And from that, you can like find out what he feels and stuff. And I was looking at it and everybody was talking about colors and I don't know what. I was like, I don't know shit. You know, it's like I'm blank screen. But the second I did like this, I just thought, you know, like now, blah, 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 blah. And the guy on the table, he starts shaking. And I was like, so maybe I do know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And then I realized it. So the only thing I had to learn was taking my perspective out from others. So I could know that yours was yours and yours was yours. And what you feel is not what I feel. Because until then, I was just reacting on everybody's feelings. I was so mad for 10 seconds, then I was so happy for 20, and then I was so sad for 12 seconds more, because there were 3 people walking by me. A little bit emotionally unstable, maybe.
May I ask you a question?
Yes, of course.
How do you handle the physical pain if it's constantly?
What is pain?
Just pain in the low back.
What is pain?
What is pain? Yeah. It's something that's constantly here.
So if it's always there and we could categorize it as something else as pain, then it could be attention or it could be awareness of something is there. The thing is, the way I handle pain, I'm not sure it works for everybody because I don't really feel pain as pain. So if I break something, for example, I broke my finger. So what happened where I felt the shock of the break. 1 second it hurts because something break, that kind of, you can feel it. But I felt that for 3 seconds. Then there were the shock of, what was that? That finger is not where it should be. And then there's the fear. The fear of, what does this bring? What will happen now? Am I gonna die? It's basically the same thing. Am I gonna die? And but there's no pain. So the real pain, the real pain was 3 seconds. Then the fear and the tension and the shocks remain. So when we have chronic pain in the lower back, for example, it is your nerve system in triggers, and it's also because it's not softness enough around it. You have to keep more warm and in that area. And it's because of you not paying attention enough to increase your own happiness within the things which happened within your childhood, so you can like ground within that. So it's not pain, it's tension. So how you deal with it is looking into it. You look into, what is it? What do it want to tell me? Why is it here? And you accept it by accepting the pain, but have focus on what doesn't hurt. Then it doesn't hurt. I can break my foot and I can be all about it. It's like, oh no, I cannot walk, I cannot do anything, it hurts so much, you know, and it's the worst thing in the world, right? But then you walk in and you make me laugh so loud, and then you make me so happy that I can only feel the laugh and the, you know, the pain in my stomach from all the laughing, right? Forget all about the food. Then there is no pain.
If you're only the lonely in your bed,
then you already answered your question.
Only the lonely.
That's the clue.
No, it is because then you have a feeling of being alone inside of yourself. Then you have a feeling of the only thing you can attach to, the only thing that can make you feel something is the suffering of you having pain. And instead of looking to your feelings of you feeling pain and feeling alone and feeling you're not good enough, you can link it to a physical pain, which allow you to take the feelings away from your true feeling of feeling alone. Then you can feel, oh, I'm suffering because of my pain. So if you look and increase the feeling behind, you don't need pain to tell you any longer.
Yeah.
Pain is funny, it's weird. Sometimes.
You're welcome.
For example, I had to learn like physical borders, and I didn't really know how to learn it. So when I fly too much out on a daily basis, so when I fly very too much out, more than I do now, I was, in a week, I broke my hand. I broke my foot, I fall down the stairs and hurt my elbow, and I actually kicked my hip out of alignment within 2 weeks because I was a little bit not grounded. So that could... Yeah. So what could I do? I could become really mad about it or really afraid about it, or I could look into, okay, what am I trying to tell me? Yeah. I was not listening to myself. I was doing way too much, and I was doing way too much for another person's perspective than my own. It was truly meant to be in that moment. I would not have changed it for anything in the world. I'm so grateful I did it. So grateful. But I was not listening to myself and my physical borders. I was not listening to like, wait, this is way too hard for my heart. This is, whew, you know, I could feel sad now. I was not listening to it. I was just like flying out. I don't feel anything. Poof, I still don't feel anything. Oh, wait a minute. Okay, I have to feel this. I have to go inside of me and actually feel, wait, I don't want this. I don't like this. It's not good for me. I choose to walk away. So pain is awesome, maybe not in the moment, but it's only there to tell us something. It's only there to help us.
Sometimes I find it hard to, I know this perspective of how to look at pain. I have these severe headaches every month. Now I have a little bit like migraine.
Migraine,
yeah. And when it hurts that bad, it's so difficult to be with it.
So before the migraine, what did you do? How much were you thinking? How much were you listening to yourself? How hard were you on yourself? Look into that. What triggers the migraine? And you have to look to some tension within your lower back and in your the top of your spine also, because it triggers something within your nervous system. So it will make it easier.
So my lower back and some...
You have like, you know, the spine?
Yeah.
So then when the lower back, there is one thing, there's tensed a little bit to one side, it automatically do the same thing in the upside, to the other side. So if you just kind of can loosen that up with thought, perspective, or feelings, or massage, or combine it,
yeah.
It will be awesome.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. But it's about letting go. It's about allowing you to be you. It's about surrender. So when you've been a boxer for 10 years, the word surrender, it took a while for me to take in. I can tell you that. You just have to surrender to your feelings. Are you kidding me? Then you keep fighting. You keep fighting and standing. No, I ain't surrendering. I'm going to stand on this side. I'm going to keep standing here. Until the second you realize what surrendering actually means. It's not surrendering in giving up or giving in or letting go. No. It's surrendering to go inside and allowing to be you and expand. Surrendering to your heart. And actually breathe within oneself. It's a pretty nice feeling. Then you can fight for fun, but you don't have to fight anymore.
Sometimes the pattern you have to drive on and don't stand still by yourself.
Yeah.
And every time you go and, oh, this is fun. And go, okay, blah, blah, blah. And then I forget to listen to myself.
Yeah.
Yes. On what you said, I say, oh, it's all familiar to me, but now it's still not getting into my heart.
No.
No.
It takes some time, and it takes time to also, like, the surrendering part to, okay, I need to do this way. I think all these things is fun. I have this a lot. Like, I want to do this and that, and I make 10 appointments. And then when the day comes, I'm like, I have to just be in the forest all alone. I want to do these things, but I just don't want to do it with people. But I don't want to be alone. Anybody know that feeling? So what do we stay true to what I believe that I want because I want it to be fun and when I'm there I'm like or do I surrender into where I am, the state I'm in right now, and right now I need to just walk around in a forest without any shoes on, even it's cold. Yes. Awesome.
In the last years, I developed myself. I think I opened my heart more.
Yeah.
I let go of patterns. Concepts are less important. And it makes me feel more free. So that's, of course, a good feeling. And I'm kind of proud of it.
Yeah, I understand that a lot. You should be proud of it.
And I wonder what you see when you look at me. Maybe it's an awkward question, but you know, it's like I'm seeing.
Let me ask you something. You look me in the eyes.
Mm-hmm.
What do you see in me?
Well, when I look at you, I can see that you're grounded, but you...
I love you. No laughing.
But that there's also a connection, higher or lower, I don't know how to...
So that is what you seek within you. You want to be grounded and open at the same time. You're welcome. When I see you, I see a beautiful heart. I see a lot of hurt. I see a lot of holding yourself down and allowing people to step over your borders so you don't allow yourself to take the room and your place and the space which you need to have confidence enough to being who you are. I see you working on it very badly, and I see you're doing a good job. I also believe that it will suit you and your soul perspective the very best if you learn to make more clear borders for where people should step over and where they shouldn't, and allow yourself to see how awesome you are and increase that so much more. You are everything you wish to become the moment you realize that you are it.
And do you think that the of you or whatever it
is? I don't think, trust me.
That the pain you see, is it mine? Is it all mine?
It is yours, and then you resonate with other people's pain and then you take it in. Because it's easier to deal with their pain than your own. But your pain will disappear when you realize that you are allowed to be here. When you allow yourself to take the space which you need, you no longer need to feel the pain of the space which you didn't take. So go have fun, seriously. What makes you happy? We are so serious, especially in this spiritual self-awareness, self-awakeness period. Oh, we have to deal with all our demons. We have to set ourselves free. We have to disattach for everything. No patterns is allowed. We have to be aware. Yeah, and awake. Sure. But the most important thing in all this is have fun. It's laugh. It's allow ourselves to increase the happiness inside of ourselves. So, yes, let's go through heavy shit, let's cry, let's be in pain, let's puke for hours doing combo, whatever, you know? But let's have fun afterwards, let's increase the happiness, let's put in some joy, let's do whatever makes us happy. And it doesn't even matter what it is. We are here to have fun, we're here to have an experience, we're here to live. We are developing ourselves within this life, because it's time of creation. I just have to say just at least once at this lecture. We are doing all that for one reason, so we can feel alive, so we can increase the frequency on Earth. But if we only deal with demons, if we only deal with letting go of the heaviness, how can we increase anything? Then we're still stuck, you know? Then it's just an ongoing process of never becoming free. So see the freedom in the in-between. Feel the freedom when you release something. See the love within every time, within every person you meet, where that love can resonate back. That's what we're here for. Let's do it.
But it will also confuse some people.
So what? Let them be confused. It doesn't matter. How are they ever supposed to learn to snap out of their perspective, snap out of their beliefs and control patterns if we keep being all nurturing about it? Oh, I don't want to hurt his feelings. No, I don't want to hurt anybody in this world. But if I'm not true to me, how will he ever learn or she ever learn to be true to herself?
Sometimes in the beginning you feel very alone because you're letting everyone down.
Tell me about it. You're not letting them down. You're standing up for you. So that is their ego that feels that down. So what you're actually doing is helping them seeing what they need to look at inside of themselves. By you staying true to that inside of you, you no longer take it in like letting them down. So you no longer step into the suffering part of being who you are. And then the doubt will start becoming less. It is not up for people to understand you. There's like 80% of the world who doesn't understand me. But it is up to me to understand myself. It's up to me to follow my heart and trust that whatever my heart is telling me, that is what is right for me. If that means that I make another person sad by me walking away, for example, then that person needs to learn from that. Then that person has something else coming which will serve that person's life. Who wants to stay a place where two persons are not true to their hearts? Who want to sit in a family gathering where you actually rather want to be another place? It is not true. Oh, let's be together Christmas Eve and eat together because we do this every Christmas, you know? If you want it, if you truly want it because this is cozy, this is a family thing and we are making chocolate pie or whatever you guys eat, then it's the most beautiful thing in the world. It's like true connection, true family feeling, increasing love. If you really want it. If you really feel that family thing. But if your mind and your heart is elsewhere, don't do it. Be true to yourself. Break the patterns. By you being the example of the pattern breaker, the black sheep, or whatever we can call it, you allow other people to see that. And it's the same on a collective level. If we just walk in the matrix because the matrix is created and therefore we have to fit in the systems, none of us like it, but we have to fit in because that's the rules. How are we ever going to change it? We are the matrix. So if everybody's just walking in the matrix, don't want to be there, we're doing it ourselves. When we start standing up for what we want, then one by one would allow themselves to. And then we can make the self-created matrix into whatever we want it to be made into. Yeah!
So you're saying we're in
quit your job? Yeah. No, yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember.
Standing up for yourself. Yeah. Yes.
So you said that we are in a sort of change?
The time of creation.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. So what does it mean?
It means that, oh, I love this. I'm going to drink a glass of water. I'm going to tell you. This is my grounding, right? So I am in the belief that in this water, in this more water, I am in the belief that within this water there is a frequency that does, when I drink it, I can feel it going through my system and my soul go down with it. In a pure form, of course, not down.
Water is grounding? What do you mean?
Yeah, so...
I'm sorry, but wait, I think there's another question.
Oh yeah, well, I'm going to answer it afterwards. So the thing is, water have a vibration, you have water inside of yourself. And so when you heal your water, then the water becomes alive. And then when you drink it, then the living vibration starts circulating inside of yourself. So you can feel the vibration going down through your system and spreading around within your physical self. That awareness of the physical inside makes me realize, hey, I have a physical body, and then I can entertain within my physical self. And therefore, water is grounding, yes.
That's how you do it.
That's how I do it.
No, but I mean, get away from your question.
Oh, we will come back.
Yeah.
Sometimes I eat red stuff also.
But what you're just telling to me, I do this thing on an individual level. So I give readings, psychic readings.
Yeah.
So, and the grounding is very important. Otherwise, your information is somewhere...
But there's
so what you just said about water, I think it's just it's your way of grounding yourself.
Yes.
Right.
That and these things, yeah. It's like what resonates with me. Just remember me like, oh, you have a physical body. Wait, you have physical borders. Oh, wait a minute, you're a person. Sometimes I have to look in the mirrors and like, I'm seriously standing like, I am Elisa. I am incarnated. Yeah. So I'm just... Wow, that is my face. So sometimes I have to have this realization but it works. Yeah. It is not the same for everybody. If you gave me this heavy black stone, My whole system will feel fear and I will jump out of my body. Yeah. So it will not work. You have to do what feels right for you. There's no rules. And that is one of the things in this time of creation. So, until the day today. Yeah. We have been incarnated over and over and over on planet Earth. We have had, at some point we had the whole karma wheel going on. And the belief that the karma wheel was there, we are in the belief of the religions and stuff like that. So when I say it's time of creation, it's because we now are developed to the place where we have the opportunity, I love you words, to become aware, that we are a spiritual being having a human experience. Yeah. And that whatever karma we had to pay is no longer. And whatever we are stuck in, we have the opportunity to become free of. So the time of creation means that we are becoming aware that we can create our own life. We can create our own world, our own future while we incarnated on this planet. We have had prophets and stuff telling us it over the years, like Jesus and Muhammad and Buddha and stuff like that. But in that time, we were not ready to take it in. In that time, the awareness was so low because the frequencies within the human perspective were so ego-minded and in control patterns that we were not ready to become aware. We were not ready to become awake. But because the frequency were so low on Earth and because we planned it many thousand years ago, now is the time. Now we have developed the frequency and the light on Earth is so high that if we do not develop with our planet, if we do not develop with that life, we will stay stuck. So this is why it's so important that we tell people about awareness. I have to stop because I can no longer remember anything. But I'm really happy and grateful that you guys is here. And I don't know about you, but I had a lot of fun.
Thank you.
So you're welcome.